Welcome back to Public Finance in Canada. I'm Keith Akucha, and here we're going to be taking a look at Welfare Economics Part 2, specifically taking a look at Arrow's Impossibility Theorem. While this is Part 2, it's actually the third video in this week's series of videos on public finance. So far, what we've covered is initially taking a look at the idea of utility indifference curves and the definition of efficiency, Pareto optimality, and potential Pareto improvements. From there, in part two, we explored the fundamental theorem of welfare economics. And then, now to wrap us up here in part two, we're going to be taking a look at Arrow's impossibility theorem. From Arrow's impossibility theorem, we're then going to wrap it all together with everything we've talked about and look at some implications and wrap up with some kind of just conversation, discussion ideas to get you thinking about what all this means. All that to be said, let's go jump over into the basis of Arrow's impossibility theorem. Really, the part with this, as we jump over, is to keep in mind that in the last video we took a look at, and again, that was with our fundamental theorem of welfare economics. We saw underneath the second theorem that there's room for a so-called benevolent social planner. That is, even if all of the assumptions of welfare economics were satisfied, there could still be room for a social planner to step in to be able to try to change that predistribution in order to achieve social goals or social notions of fairness to get that social idea of the distribution that we would like. What we're going to see as we carry on with this, with Arrow's impossibility theorem, is that even though there's room for a benevolent social planner, it might be a bit more difficult for this planner to discern a socially optimal outcome than we may desire. We will see that, in fact, this may be impossible to discern apart from having a complete dictatorship. And by no means are we pushing for a dictatorship in this way at all, but that is going to be essentially the outcome of Arrow's impossibility theorem. Okay, as with the fundamental theorem of welfare economics, Arrow's impossibility theorem is a rigorous mathematical proof that we are simplifying here for the ease of understanding. So keep that in mind. This is a step away from all of the behind the scenes of Arrow's impossibility theorem, just to focus on the conclusions. Again, though, in order to really be able to understand the conclusions of this theorem, what we first need to be able to understand are the assumptions. So, to take a look at the assumptions of Arrow's impossibility theorem, to relate these back to our fundamental theorems of welfare economics, I would say these are not as heroic of assumptions. We kind of criticized the assumptions of the fundamental theorem of welfare economics as being a bit heroic, as not really applying to all markets and places out there. The assumptions in Arrow's impossibility theorem are a lot more simple, they're a lot more commonplace, they're less heroic in nature. So let's take a look at these assumptions. First one is that any decision that we're trying to make, and again, we're kind of thinking about this from the view of a benevolent social planner. So, okay, hey, we're trying to figure out, do we go with a predistribution A or a predistribution B? What's going on here? What is society's preferences? How can we figure this out? So from this viewpoint, it's saying that, hey, whatever decision we are to make, this decision can be determined irrespective of voting preferences. So we should get the same kind of result irrespective as to how we go about voting. Second one is saying that all of our preferences need to be able to be ranked. And so all of these preferences need to be able to be ranked, and it should be a consistent rank. Three, kind of a logical outcome. If a majority of our voters, they favor A to B, well, then society must as well favor A to B, right? Makes sense. If we have 75% of people saying that, hey, outcome A is preferred, well, then if 75% of voters say that outcome A is preferred, then society must prefer A to B as well. Four, we must have consistency. I mean, again, this seems pretty common sense. In this case here, we're saying, hey, if A is greater than B, that is, if we prefer A to B, and then additionally, we prefer B to C, Well, then it must be the case that if we were to ignore B, we must then also prefer A over C. So we must have these consistent rankings taking place throughout. Five, ranking should only depend on what we're ranking. So that is, if we're just looking at A and B, our preference for A and B should only depend on A and B. If we include C into this choice, it shouldn't influence whether or not we like A or like B. Now, people sometimes get upset with this. They're like, well, yeah, okay, I prefer A to B, but maybe by throwing C in, it does change things. And it really shouldn't, right? What it should be looking at in this case is saying, okay, yeah, sure. Let's say I prefer A to B and throwing C in. You're like, well, maybe I prefer C more than A. Well, then, okay, that's fine. All we should then have is that you prefer A to C and you prefer C to B, which is, right, going right back to what we said in point four, is that, hey, if we just ignored C, well, you should just be left with that you prefer A to B. So that's really what we're getting at there, is it isn't going to be one of those situations where, hey, I prefer A to B, but once we include C, well, then I prefer C to B to A, and you flip it all together. That it really doesn't make any sense for that to happen. So just saying in this case here that, hey, your rankings are consistent and they're independent of the introduction of another decision, another choice. Finally, option six is we make the assumption of no dictatorship, right? If it was a dictatorship, we wouldn't have to go through this whole ideal of trying to determine social preferences, because if we had a dictatorship, the dictator could just say, hey, this is your social preference. This is what we're going to do. This is what you want. We only need to worry about trying to determine social preferences if we're in a democratic kind of state and we want to actually figure out, hey, all of our constituents, what are your preferences? So need to have that final assumption there of no dictatorship. Okay, so what exactly does all of this work out for us then? Well, let's go take a look. Let's take a look at the basis of Arrow's impossibility theorem. And to simplify, right, and it doesn't need this simplification, but it just makes it a lot easier if we do simplify in this way. We're going to presume that we have three voters, right, or three constituents or three members of our society. Again, just a simplification, we could have more. And similarly, we're going to have three policies to choose between. And again, we could have more, but three just kind of keeps it simple. And so, but amongst these three voters and amongst these three policies, we're going to have the following ordering. So we're going to have voter one, voter two, and voter three. We're going to presume that voter one, they're going to be just our standard, hey, I like policy A the best, A is better than B, and B is better than C. So A greater than B, B greater than C. For person two, we're going to go, hey, they like B the best, B is greater than C, and C is greater than A. And then finally, for person three, they're going to like C the best, and they prefer C over A, and they prefer A over B. Okay, so given these preferences amongst our three voters, or alternatively amongst our three voter groups, we want to figure out what is the best policy to pursue? What is society's wishes? Right? What is the social outcome that is most desirable in this case? And right, keeping in mind with our fifth assumption there, ranking of A and B only depends on A and B, and ranking four, that they're consistent, that is, hey, if we drop one of them, it shouldn't change anything, we can go through voting in a pairwise fashion. And so if we were to go through voting in a pairwise fashion, that is, we would start off by saying, okay, everybody here, policy A or policy B? Well, if we go through this here in this scenario, we take a look at it and we go, okay, voter one, they prefer A. over B. Voter two, they're going to prefer B. And voter three, they're going to prefer A. So, okay, A wins out over B. A wins out over B. We get two-thirds choose A. Okay, so given that, and given our third assumption that if a majority favor one thing, then that's what society favors, we see that, hey, in this pairwise fashion, A wins out, and we should choose policy A. Great. So we choose policy A. But then what? Well, let's say we pick a different pairwise fashion. Let's say we choose B or C. Well, in this case, if we're comparing B or C, well, we get voter one choosing B over C. We get voter two choosing B over C. So, okay, again, we get two-thirds will choose B. So again, we get a majority choosing policy B. Majority choosing policy B, meaning society is choosing policy B. Oh, okay. This is kind of getting a bit odd if you're working through this. Okay, final case. Let's do a pairwise comparison of C or A. Okay, if we go through this, C or A. Well, okay, person one, they prefer A. Person two, they prefer C. Person three, they also prefer C. So, okay, two votes for C, three votes for C. So, again, we get two-thirds of the people in society will choose C. So, we get a bit of an oddity going on here, right? Altogether, we get six-thirds altogether, right? Like everybody's voting for everything. How does this? It turns out to be a complete paradox. And really, if it doesn't pop out right away to be a complete paradox, let's take a look at this. So as we go through it, we get that, okay, as we go through it, two-thirds prefer A over B. So that is, we could prefer A over B. And then we went, okay, well, what about B or C? Well, okay, we said that we prefer B over C. So okay, we prefer B over C. And then we said, okay, well, what about between C and A? Well, we said, okay, between C and A, I prefer C over A. If you don't really see it quite yet, we have a circular result. That is, if we were to invoke kind of our, what was that there? Our assumption four that they must be consistent, we could drop B altogether. And you'll see that we're saying, okay, yeah, A is preferred to C, but C is preferred to A, right? It's circular. It's circular. We don't actually have any consistent preference. This is problematic. How does a benevolent social planner who's trying to put in a policy that maximizes social welfare, how are they able to discern which policy is best for society? They can't. They're stuck. They run into this problem. They run into this difficulty that arises. And this is the basis of Arrow's impossibility theorem. Now, what exactly does this mean? Well, what Arrow's impossibility theorem really comes to the conclusion of is that it just rejects the notion that there is such a thing as a collective democratic will, right? That society on whole has this collective idea as to what's best, and government just needs to find out what that collective idea is and impose it. Instead, what it is it's just saying, yeah, you know what? There is no collective democratic will. There's a whole bunch of different opinions. And the problem is that as soon as you start reaching out to society on whole, these preferences can become circular, they can become paradoxical, and there is no one true ideal policy that is out there existing. And right, kind of a tie to this is that Arrow's impossibility theorem is just completely denying that there could be objective basic needs or universal criteria for collective decision making, at least one that policymakers should recognize. Because this group might think this is a better basic need, this one might agree that that one's a better one. But once you start looking at all the groups together, you end up with these paradoxical results. So we seem to kind of have this bit of a problem. The fundamental welfare theorem of economics first theorem says, hey, leave markets alone. A complete market on its own will reach a Pareto optimal outcome. So that is first fundamental theorem of welfare economics. Leave markets alone, right? This here is the whole basis of our laissez-faire economics. That is hands off, just leave it be. And that whole idea there is, hey, given any distribution, we will reach a Pareto optimal outcome. It will be efficient. And because it's Pareto optimal, if you try to mess with it, you're just going to make things worse off altogether. Second fundamental, theorem of welfare economics. Second fundamental theorem of welfare economics, it went and stated and said, hey, if, right, you weren't happy with that initial Pareto optimal outcome, you could change, a little triangle here, that's the Greek letter delta, used to signify change. You can change the pre-distribution, and any changed pre-distribution will then yield a new updated Pareto optimal outcome. Mind you, if you compare the initial Pareto outcome to the new Pareto optimal outcome, there is going to be winners and losers. That is, you're not getting an actual Pareto improvement, but you will get to a new, different Pareto efficient, Pareto optimal outcome. And that is, you could then change this pre-distribution, change this allocation of resources, and your rationale for doing this would be to achieve social notions of fairness. Or, right, instead of fairness, we could say, or equity. Okay, so that was the basic idea of our fundamental theorems of welfare economics. We then go and say, essentially, government don't touch. Government only touch if you're going to change the economy, the markets, to achieve notions of fairness or equity. We then go and move on and we say, okay, with Arrow's impossibility theorem, Arrow's impossibility theorem, Arrow's impossibility theorem is really saying, hey, there is no way to determine what society's notions of fairness or equity are. And so Arrow's impossibility theorem is really just saying, hey, there's no way to figure out what is the ideal fairness or ideal notion of equity. So again, might as well just do nothing. So it seems so far that based off of our fundamental theorem of welfare economics, based off of Arrow's impossibility theorem, we're really just paving the ground for laissez-faire economics. Again, laissez-faire economics is just that belief that government has no role, that government needs to step back, that the free market is the best market, and there's no role for anyone there. Okay, this is hardly the case. And yes, Arrow's impossibility theorem says that, hey, it's going to be extremely difficult, if not impossible, to get ideas of social welfare. Doesn't mean we go and we throw the baby out with the bathwater. Rather, we recognize that there are limitations. There are limitations in constructing aggregate preferences, right? And going to our constituents and saying, hey, do you prefer policy A, policy B, or policy C? Severe limitations in that. However, notions of social welfare, right? As we go and we measure these different policies, we're unlikely to get the answer. We're unlikely to get the correct view from society as to what fairness is or as to what policy is ideal. But these are still often useful in order to reveal different sets of preferences, right? Different value judgments held by the constituents. So This whole exercise, yes, it will fail. Yes, it is an impossible task. It's that Sisyphean task of pushing the boulder up the hill only to have it roll back down. It is impossible in nature. However, by doing it, you are going to be able to tease out what is important to your constituents, what is important to your voters. And by doing so, you can limit your possible options, and you can then make choices based off of budgetary concerns, based off of other items, other concerns that may be relevant as a government. So altogether, where does this leave us? Well, as we said, initially, this leaves us in this ground that it's kind of like, hey, we should just have laissez-faire economics. And I would really reject this. I would say that, yes, if you just looked at the fundamental theorem of welfare economics and said, hey, yeah, based off of that, government has really no role. The only possible role is to intervene to achieve social notions of fairness. But then you point at arrows and you say, hey, based off of arrows, we can't ever actually figure out what is a social notion of fairness. So really, the government should just back off. Leave markets alone, let them do their own thing. Well, like I said, I reject this. I don't see this as really the outcome of this. And the reason being, as I've kind of alluded to a few times, is the heroic assumptions. That is the heroic assumptions needed for our fundamental theorem of welfare economics. And again, if we go back and look at these assumptions were no market power. And we said, what was market power? Market power was the ability for any one economic agent to be able to influence prices in their favor. That is essentially a world without one large employer. A world without your Walmarts, a world without your Amazons, without your Googles, a world without your monopolies, without your oligopolies. This is even your large employers. Look at hospitals. If you are a nurse, you really have one option as to who's going to hire you. That one person who gets to hire you, your health authority, they have market power. Unions have market power that they exercise in balance with those large employers. All of this is market power. All of this does exist in the world around us. So, okay, first heroic assumption, market power. Maybe this no market power thing isn't really true. Our second one that we talked about is this assumption that there's no externalities. Okay, no externalities. Again, for some goods, for some services, maybe this is true. Maybe there isn't any external costs or external benefits attached to the production or consumption of that good or service. The problem is, for many goods and services, there are externalities attached to them. So, again, to say that, hey, there's no externalities in place, a rather heroic assumption. If there's a case of externalities, again, there's a case of government intervention. Third case, or third assumption rather, and again, I'll highlight that these are heroic assumptions, would be, again, I'm going to write it in this no public goods. That is, every good out there is private in nature. We don't have the problems that are associated with public goods. As we've seen, as we went through defining and talking about what these different three types of public goods are, we see that these public goods are all around us. And by these public goods being all around us, again, we have a case for government intervention. So, again, our issue, our potential problem there. I'm going to throw in a fourth one. This isn't one we talked about as a heroic assumption. And that is, again, because it's not really explicitly listed as an assumption, but it is implicitly there. And that is a fourth one. And the fourth one is that there is no asymmetric information. So, okay, what does this mean? No asymmetric information. That is, asymmetric information does not exist. That means everybody has all the same information. Everybody has access to all information in real time. They're able to process and compute and analyze that information in real time to all come to the same decision. Hopefully, you can look at that and kind of scoff and go, that's a ridiculous assumption. And yeah, it is. Turns out the presence of asymmetric information is all around us, and this asymmetric information has massive effects on the markets around us as well. In fact, through the use of asymmetric information, certain economic agents are able to use it in order to obtain market power. Quick example of this would be a simple case of you bringing your car into the mechanic. In this case here, we'll say that you are limited in your mechanical know-how, hence why you're bringing it into the mechanic, and really you're at the mercy of that mechanic's honesty. The mechanic could say that your flux capacitor needs to be changed, and if you did not know any better, you would be forking out the money in order to make that happen. In that case there, you are just entirely handing over money for nothing to be done, and you are at a loss due to this asymmetric information. Presence of asymmetric information creates these market distortions. It allows one side to have market power and to influence the price in their favor. So again, we see in the world around us quite often the presence of asymmetric information. So that is, yes, if these assumptions were satisfied, yes, we have this case for laissez-faire economics. That is, yes, we have a case for the government to step back, for the government to not intervene. However, we see that these assumptions are probably more often than not satisfied. That is, if they're not satisfied, our theorem of welfare economics breaks down and the conclusions break down. And thus, well, we may very well have a cause for the government to intervene. Well, if the government were to intervene, what exactly is happening? And this here really leads us to our next big theory that exists. And this one here is known as the theory of second best. Our theory of second best. And really, it's based off of the premise that maybe one or more of the assumptions of our fundamental theorem of welfare economics are false. And that is, if they were all true, if our fundamental theorem of welfare economics could be satisfied, if those outcomes could exist, that would be our first best scenario, right? That would be economic nirvana. That's where we would want to be. But maybe those assumptions don't work, and thus we're going to end up at this second best scenario. Okay, so if not all markets are able to reach a Pareto optimal outcome, it may. So what is this saying? It may be possible to increase social welfare. That is, if we're increasing social welfare, that is, we are able to make a Pareto improvement, we may be able to have this to get a more Pareto optimal outcome by, this is going to seem really odd, by introducing more distortions. And okay, let's talk about why this might be. The real idea with this is that it likely is going to be impossible to remove the initial distortion. That is, it's going to likely be impossible to get rid of market power. It's going to be impossible to eliminate the externality, impossible to eliminate public goods, right? These things exist. So, because it's going to be impossible to get rid of them, we might be able to increase social welfare, have a potential or a Pareto improvement by introducing farther distortions. These farther distortions, well, these farther distortions, they may counteract the first. Right, they may counteract the first, giving us a higher level of social welfare. It might not bring us to that first best solution that we were hoping for, but it may bring us to a second best solution. That is higher than where we would have been had we done nothing. An example of this that we're seeing in the world around us today is if we go back to our case of our negative production externality. So negative production externality, where we have the pollution, and we're saying, hey, this here is a negative externality. How do we make it so that this negative production externality actually shows up in the price of that automobile? Again, just carrying on from that example we looked at earlier. How do we make sure that shows up in the price? Well, the way we do it is we put on a tax. We put on a tax that the firm has to pay in order to pollute. What do we call this tax? Well, depending on where you are, you call it an emissions tax or a carbon tax, right? In that case, there, you now have to pay per ton of pollution that you release. In this case here, you are now incorporating this external cost into your production process. You're actually explicitly making it part of your production process. By making it part of your production process, you make it part of the price, and thus you start to align that private cost with the social cost. And that is the big benefit there. Might not be able to get us all the way to that first best scenario, but is definitely able to get us to a second best scenario that is able to get us to a higher level of social welfare that was a potential or an actual Pareto improvement over where we were without the additional distortion, that is, without the carbon tax. Okay, so altogether this week, what have we looked at? We started off taking a look at efficiency. From efficiency, we introduced Pareto efficiency or a Pareto optimal outcome. With that, we talked about Pareto improvements. That is a way to increase the outcome of everyone in society without hurting anybody, as well as a potential Pareto improvement. That was increasing social welfare, maybe at the cost of one person, but the gains to the other person were so great that you were able to compensate the loser. So that was our initial bit. Efficiency, Pareto optimality, and Pareto improvements, potential Pareto improvements. From there, we introduced utility, we introduced indifference curves, all of this to build up to an Edgeworth box. The Edgeworth box was used to see that, hey, we can have an initial distribution that is efficient, but not necessarily Pareto optimal. And that is, it's not Pareto optimal because we can still have a Pareto improvement and we can just get there on our own. We then utilize that to take a look at the fundamental theorem of welfare economics to say, hey, look at this. If we just left markets alone, assuming our assumptions are met, if we just left markets alone, we could reach these Pareto optimal outcomes just on our own, just by laissez-faire, let it be, hands-off situation. This was Adam Smith's invisible hand. We made the case that the only real reason to have government intervention was the second fundamental theorem of welfare economics. That was to change the initial predistribution. By changing that initial predistribution, we might be able to get to an Pareto optimal outcome that is more socially ideal, that is more closely matches our social preferences for fairness or equity. Unfortunately, we then threw a wrench in that argument by introducing Arrow's impossibility theorem, which then states, hey, there's no such thing as a social notion of fairness or equity. It is impossible to aggregate these preferences. It will be impossible to determine a collective democratic will. And as such, that whole bit falls apart, and it seems that again, it just brings up this case for laissez-faire, let everything be. Government get lost, let the free market stand. We wrapped up by saying, hey, let's actually criticize some of these theories, some of these assumptions rather, not theories, some of these assumptions for our fundamental theorem of welfare economics. And we see that these assumptions are rather heroic in nature. And as they're rather heroic in nature, maybe our fundamental theorem of welfare economics does not actually hold. Maybe we're not able to reach this Pareto optimal level on our own. And as such, through our theory of the second best, we may in fact have a role for the government to play. Okay, that does us for the content for this. To wrap us off, some discussion questions, some things to kind of think about with respect to everything we've talked about. So let's start off by taking a look at a case where we have a market failure, right? And so a market failure, what does that mean exactly? A market failure is any time one of those four needed assumptions for our fundamental theorem of welfare economics is not satisfied. So that is, we could have market power, we could have externalities, we could have presence of public goods, we could have this asymmetric inter or this asymmetric information. So big part here is, say we have this market failure. Our fundamental theorem of welfare economics cannot be satisfied. Good. Is this really a case for the government to intervene? Or should we still kind of uphold this whole laissez-faire kind of mind frame? Well, okay, first thing to consider. So one of the things to keep in mind is that, say we have this market failure of market power. That is, okay, a firm has market power, they're able to influence the price. By doing so, this violates our assumption. We're not going to reach a Pareto optimal outcome. However, by being able to influence the price, these firms are also able to engage in research and development. This research and development provides us new variety, new selection, it provides us new technologies. All of this technological advancement has been shown to be a very good thing to society and to consumers. Should the government intervene in order to restrict market power? Should we restrict the Microsofts, the Apples, the Googles, the Teslas of the world that have significant market power? They give us the benefit of the outcomes of this research and development, the spillover effects, as you will, but yet we also face the costs of that in the sense where they charge higher prices. This higher prices reduces market and social welfare altogether. So, again, a debate to be had. Should we intervene even if we're unable to maintain a Pareto optimal or a maximized level of social welfare? Alternatively, say we have a failure amongst the line of externalities. There are many externalities where people say, hey, government has no role to play. So, for example, the secondhand smoke debate, many people argue this should be dealt with entirely interpersonally. That, hey, that's just strictly as something to be dealt with between you and the other person. Government, police, bylaw, whoever have you, does not need to get involved. Okay, that seems like a rather simple case of an externality. What about bigger picture problems? What about situations like vaccinations? What about situations like climate change? These are a lot bigger picture. These have a lot bigger concerns and a lot more kickback. Taking a look at vaccinations in particular, well, the choice to not get vaccinated, yes, that is a personal choice. Yes, that has personal costs and benefits. However, as we limit the amount of vaccinations, if we don't reach a certain threshold of vaccinations, it has a social cost. As viruses then are able to mutate, are able to change, are able to spread through the population and affect people who are unable to become vaccinated because of someone else's choice. So, as a result, what is the role of government intervention here? Should the government get involved in order to correct externalities, or should the government not have a say and back off and let this be dealt with interpersonally? Again, big area of debate. What about our non-private goods? That is, our public goods. To a degree, many of these can be privatized. And many would argue that even in this case of these public goods or non-private goods, that the government should just stay out, laissez-faire. Why should the government, or rather, why should the taxpayer be burdened in the provision of these goods? So we're starting off with our true public goods, things like public parks. Well, instead of the government providing public parks, they could just allow for the zoning of larger lots. The zoning of larger lots allows for private backyards. These private backyards are, to a degree, a substitute for the public park. Trade-off to be had. What about instead of police? Right? Again, policing would be a public good. Instead of policing a taxpayer burden, a government burden, you could offload this onto the private sector by more security systems, private security. You could also offload it through higher levels of insurance, being like, hey, guess what? Criminal activities, theft, it's going to happen. Instead of preventing it, you can just insure against it. These are viable solutions. As a society, though, are they solutions that we want? For club goods, infrastructure, roads, rec center, etc., all of these, they could be provided by private firms. We could have private provisions of sewers, private provisions of water, of roadways, of bridges, of tunnels, all of this. Again, is this what we want as a society, or would we rather this placed on the public sector, on the government to provide it? If the private sector were to provide it, it would not be able to achieve a Pareto optimal outcome. It would not be able to maximize our social welfare. And again, that is because of this assumption of non-private goods not being satisfied. Same thing can be said for common resource goods to wrap us off. Forests, fisheries, etc., 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 they can be managed through private ownership. To a degree, here on Vancouver Island, this is what we've done. Instead of allowing forestry of crown land, we have allowed this crown land to be leased out to private firms such as Mosaic to allow them the right to forest, to log and replant certain plots of land. It has been successful in managing this property, in managing this resource in a sustainable way. However, there are social costs associated with it. These social costs include loss of access to otherwise public land. So, some issues there. This, however, was just taking a look at cases where we have these assumptions not being satisfied and saying, hey, maybe even though it's not satisfied, maybe even though we don't have our social welfare being maximized, maybe we don't need government intervention. Maybe the free market can still do it on its own. Flip side of it, what if all of our assumptions are actually upheld? What if, on its own, our fundamental theorem of welfare economics actually works and we're actually able to reach a Pareto optimal outcome that is a socially welfare maximizing outcome? Should we have government step in? Or, hey, in that case, there is that like, hey, you know what? All of our assumptions were satisfied. Laissez-faire, government, get lost, step back. The free market has got this. Well, let's take a look. First one, healthcare. For all intents and purposes, healthcare is actually a private good. It is both rivalrous and excludable, meaning the free market can provide this at a Pareto optimal level. So, why should we burden taxpayers? Why should we burden the government through the provision of this service? It's a big debate to be had. Most developed countries have decided that yes, this should be a taxpayer service. Some, primarily our neighbors to the south, have decided that hey, this is a private good and it should be provided by private firms. Pros and cons to each. In our case, and in many developed countries' cases, we have kind of applied the second theorem of welfare economics to this, and we've said, yes, this could be provided by the free markets, and yes, it could be a case where if we just let it be, it would reach some outcome, but we can get involved, we can change the pre-distribution, we can change things up, and we can reach kind of a more socially optimal outcome. Maybe not a welfare maximizing one, but a socially optimal outcome. Similar argument can be made for many professional services. As you go through investment advisors, engineers, doctors, architects, real estate agents, etc., etc. They all need licenses. They all need government intervention to say, hey, yes, you are licensed. Yes, you passed a test. Yes, you are competent enough to do your job. These mandates, these professional exams, these accreditations, these are actually all interfering. These are actually all distorting a Pareto optimal outcome. That is, all of our assumptions are satisfied through our fundamental theorem of welfare economics, yet we put these restrictions in place. Why? Why do we do this? Should we be doing this? The argument for it, of course, is that we need to protect people from other people. If we didn't regulate doctors, there would be some really bad doctors out there that would potentially kill or severely hurt people. Yes, the free market would eventually figure that out. You wouldn't go to the bad doctors, you'd only go to the good doctors. The bad doctors would eventually be run out. Okay. Yes, in theory that works. Yes, over time that works. But in the meantime, there's architects and engineers building buildings that are falling down until we figure that out. So, to protect those people in that interim, the government's decided maybe we should get involved. Is this an ideal situation, though? Again, depending on society, depending on the social view, some societies have decided to regulate these professions more heavily. Other societies have decided not to either regulate them heavily at all or not to regulate them at all. So, again, a case where all of our assumptions are satisfied, but yet the government still intervenes. Question is, should the government still be intervening? Same kind of argument can be made for the market for right now is illicit drugs. Many of our assumptions are satisfied in order for these markets to be reaching Pareto optimal outcomes. Despite this, governments have completely restricted, that is, they've drawn a line in the sand to say, hey, these drugs are legal, these drugs are not legal. Arguably, this is rather an arbitrary line in the sand. Many of these decisions draw back to kind of European path dependency, but just the same, we have just arbitrarily decided as a society, as a government, these certain products, these certain goods, drugs are allowed to be bought and sold. These ones are not allowed to be bought and sold. That is, we have stepped in as the government and we have said we are not going to allow this market to form. By not allowing this market to form, we have prevented a Pareto optimal outcome from existing. And the question is, should this be the case? Should the government step into these situations, or is the argument there that, hey, just as with the drugs and alcohol that are legalized, is it up to the personal individual responsibility to enjoy responsibly? Big question to be had. Again, case where all of our assumptions are satisfied, yet we have government intervention. Should we or should we not? Okay. That does us for our overview of welfare economics. As we said, we've taken a look at really some big reasons for the government to get involved, some reasons why maybe the government shouldn't get involved. We looked at this through the use of our fundamental theorem of welfare economics, through Arrow's impossibility theorem, and we said, hey, if these hold, yeah, it's really hard to make a case for government intervention. At the same time, we've just gone through a bunch of examples here where all these assumptions do hold, and yet we still typically are in favor of government intervention, as we just went through. On the flip side, we took a look at cases where those assumptions don't hold, where the fundamental theorem of welfare economics breaks down, where Arrow's impossibility theorem breaks down. And yet, despite that, despite the fact that on its own, the market is not able to be socially optimal, we have still decided as a government, as a society, not to do anything about it. So that is, we have our theories, we have our reason for or to not have intervention, but yet we witness in the world around us the reason to or not to have intervention in markets seems rather ad hoc, seems rather due to historical consequences, seems rather due to a bit of path dependency. Okay. If you have any questions about anything we've covered in this chapter, anything we've covered in these series of videos, please feel free to reach out. Please feel free to comment below, to post on D2L, and of course, please feel free to send me an email. Thanks, until next time.